you for joining us. I am Jose Cardenas. The Democrat and Republican parties both have their positions when it comes to SB 1070 and immigration. Here in Arizona, the new law has two Hispanic Republican groups divided on this and other issues. Here to talk about these differences and to tell us more about their organizations is Jesse Hernandez, Chairman and Executive Director for the Arizona Latino Republican Association, and DeeDee Garcia Blase, Organizer and Founder of Somos Republicans. Welcome to both of you.
Thank you.
DeeDee, let's start with you. Tell us a little bit about your organization, when it was founded, what it does.
Okay, well, we founded Somos Republicans in 2009, April. We grew rapidly because, I saw a need for Hispanic Republican organization, an organization that went into the neighborhoods and listened to Hispanic needs. In Arizona alone, we now have 4,000 members. We just expanded to California. Now we have 249 members in Texas. And we have formed a Midwestern group, and now soon to be Virginia.
Your comments suggest that there was a void that you saw. What was that void?
Well,
and you had people like
the group ALRA, if you take a look at their website, they haven't changed it. It still has Viva Bush. It wasn't trendy and up to date, and so I just felt that there was a need for a more trendier type of organization, new blood.
Any involvement? You were referring to Jesse's organization, but what about involvement with other established figures, Hispanic Republicans such as Jaime Molera, former superintendent of public instruction in Arizona, Ruben Alvarez, former policy advisor to Governor Hull on Mexico, Bettina Nava, who's been very involved in the Republican Party. Any connection with them or any criticism that maybe they weren't filling the need that you thought needed to be filled?
I have worked with Ruben and Jaime, and they've been supportive of us. I see Ruben especially as the godfather of Latino Republicanism here in the state of Arizona, so I have a lot of respect for him. With regard to Bettina, I did work with her during the McCain 2008 primary elections, but we haven't had much contact after that. It's mostly been with Ruben and picking his brain with regard to Arizona.
So is your concern in terms of the need for a different voice for Arizona Latino Republicans with Jesse's group, ALRA?
Yes.
Jesse, tell us about your group.
Well, ALRA was founded around 2002. I was the original founder of the organization, was Jose Esparza. I was head of the organization to about 2004, when I resigned to run against Harry Mitchell in Tempe. And under his leadership, things have happened. Ms. Blase is very correct. The organization, and we expanded very quickly, and then we went into a law where we did not move as quickly as we wanted to. I was asked to come back in April of this year, and basically, I'll be very candid with you, since I've taken over, we have started to grow very quickly, and she's talking about there was a need that's been void. I agree with her, because I believe in the Latino community, they try to picture us as being very monolithic, in a sense that we're all going to agree, but there is a void that I felt that there needed a true conservatorship in our with the Latino community. We're pro-life, fiscal responsible, and with ALRA, with me taking over the helm again, we've been able to move our board. We have been able to move it in the right direction, and we're very fortunate. Steve Montenegro sits on my board, Ella Slada from Copper State Consulting, Margaret Garcia Dugan, who's running for public instruction, is part of our organization. And we have Jenna Contreras, who's running for Congress. So, there's a need for conservative Latinos out there, and we have met that. Now, ALRA in the past, unfortunately, tried to play the middle ground, trying to appease both sides. And that was not working. And with ALRA, the difference between her group and our group, we take a very strong position, and we will not waver. And that's what sets us apart from them. We're not the biggest organization, but then again, I like to think we're small but mighty. We're the special forces.
How big are you?
We don't have very many people. I would say at the top 500 500 people here in the state of Arizona. And we're constantly growing because our website is outdated. We're going through a remodeling right now. Like I said, I took over the helm back in April. Right now we're in the process of becoming a 501c4 so we can really start getting politically involved, start taking on some campaigns, taking on some candidates. So we're still in the redevelopment stage right now. So once we get our websites going, now we belong to the National Republican Latino Council, which we are in 22 states. Rick Rios is the chairman. I'm constantly talking with them. Matter of fact, we're going to have a lot of Latinos coming out from California in October in support of us.
Now, let me ask you this. The two issues that you said your group stood for, fiscal responsibility and I think in terms of pro-life?
Pro-life, yes.
Yeah. Do you really think your positions differ from Somos Republicans on those two issues?
I think we're different I do because in the conservatives, when I think about, I know they're pro-life, but sometimes when we have an issue, I give you an example. Let's take SB 1070.
Well, before, okay. we're going to talk a lot about SB 1070 and immigration, but on what many would consider core issues for conservative Republicans, do you really think there's much difference between your group and Somos Republicans?
And those right there on pro-life, probably not.
And then when you're talking about them wavering on issues, what were you referring to? Is it immigration?
Immigration, yes.
So DeeDee, what do you think sets your group apart from all right?
Immigration only.
Is that the issue?
Correct.
And so before it became such a hot issue, were you basically in agreement with the positions that all was taking?
Not really.
And what's your concern with them?
Well, the Arpaio issue, some of his members like Alice Lara were endorsed by Arpaio and Andrew Thomas. Janet, the people that he sides with, such as Janet Contreras, those are the kinds of candidates that I believe hurts the Republican Party.
How so?
Well, we're the fastest growing population here in the state. We've got a bunch of young kids who are going to be adults soon and of voting age. And according to the Pew Hispanic Report, over 85% of the total Hispanic population are against laws such as SB 1070. You can't, in the way that I want to handle immigration is via the free enterprise way, the Cato Institute way. And I believe that the Republican Party embraces competitive labor, and there's a need for competitive labor. And if it weren't for the immigrants, I believe our nation would have already been bankrupt.
So would you favor a guest worker program?
Absolutely.
Now, Jesse, there are many who think that the Republican Party is either committing suicide or at least shooting themselves in the foot by coming out so strong on the immigration issue. They had been making inroads in terms of recruiting and gaining votes from the Hispanic community. President Bush election, his re-election did fairly well, 44%,
yeah.
I think. Are you concerned at all that this is going to cost the positions that the Republican Party is taking, the positions that your group is taking, are taking on the immigration issues is going to defeat that progress?
I don't think it is. You know, people have to understand, the last time we had an amnesty program was under President Reagan, and we were going to have another amnesty program under President Bush. But I don't feel that it's going to hurt us, because when I'm out there talking, see, people tend to think that we're so monolithic. When I go talking at functions and stuff, I have more people from Guatemala, El Salvador coming to me saying thanking me for taking this position, our group for taking this position, because they're saying that the needs of the Mexicanos from Mexico are not the same of ours. And they keep telling me, one thing I keep hearing from them, they're saying is they work so hard to get their legal status, and the fact that if we were to have an amnesty program that is being touted by a lot of politicians, it cheapens their citizenship. Because they work so hard for it.
But 60 to 70% of the Hispanic population in the United States, both documented and undocumented, is of Mexican descent. So isn't there concern that Arizona will experience the same thing that happened in California? The backlash to Prop 187 there will drive Hispanics who might otherwise, and demographic polls indicate, trend Republican, will drive them back to the Democratic Party?
I don't think that's going to happen, because you have to remember, I keep hearing Proposition 187. This is not the first time. We had Prop 200, and we didn't see the backlash from Prop 200. This is not the first time. The last bill that went through went to Janet Napolitano's desk. It was very similar to, you know, the predecessor to SB 1070. We didn't have the backlash. So if we would have had the backlash, we would have had it back then when Prop 200 passed. You know, the doing away with the benefits, the entitlements, and those type of things. And I have yet to see that. In California, it happened rapidly. We have not seen this in Arizona yet.
Let me come back to that. But before that, DeeDee, a lot of controversy right now over some comments made by Senator Harry Reid to the effect of he doesn't understand why any Hispanic would vote Republican. Isn't that a legitimate question, especially given the concerns you have with the positions that the Republican Party is taking on immigration?
I think it is a question, but I think he made a comment that had prejudice, the old Southern way of thinking. He also made a similar comment about Obama.
Which got him in a lot of trouble.
Right.
Yeah.
So,
but what do you tell, when you're out recruiting, and I know that one of your goals is to generate greater voter participation by Hispanics in the Republican Party, what do you tell those people who say, why would I be a Republican, given the positions that the Republican Party is taking on immigration?
Well, number one is pro-life. I believe we are, you know, pro-Second Amendment. A lot of Mexican Americans do become business owners. They quickly, when they become business owners, they quickly find out how government gouges them with taxes. So as they become business owners and they realize the bureaucracy that they have to deal with as small business owners, then they eventually become Republicans. So they belong here.
So your point would be that it's not a one issue thing, and there are other reasons for Hispanics to be attracted to the Republican Party. And Jesse, that does seem to be certainly the pitch and the basis for some of the inroads that Republicans have made amongst Hispanics. But going back to 187, what the analysis seems to be that what happened there is that they went too far. And so you had videos of very ominous videos of people crossing the border, and talked about invasion and so forth. The kind of rhetoric that at a certain point drove people who might support the kinds of things that Hispanic voters have supported in the past here in Arizona, that some might say are anti-immigrant, saying, and now it's getting too personal. And so, I've seen, for example, video of you at a press conference standing next to Pamela Gorman, who I think you introduced her, and she gets up and she starts talking about rapes, beheadings, molestation, all the things that she says SB 1070 was designed to help. And isn't that an insult to all Hispanics? Because it implies that Hispanics are more prone to those kinds of crimes, even though nobody's been able to find anybody who's been beheaded or whose beheading would have been prevented by SB 1070. Isn't that part of the problem?
Well, you know, I think, you know, when Pam got up to her, you know, basically, you know, she works very close with the police department, and, you know, that's the information. But to say that the Latinos are the only one that contribute to that kind of stuff, no, that's not.
Isn't she implying that, though?
You know, if you were to look at that, yes, she is implying that does occur, that does happen.
And I mean, shouldn't your group be disassociating themselves from that kind of rhetoric?
Not really, because basically the fact that she supports SB 1070, we're not going to agree on everything. You know, just like the pro-amnesty people don't agree on everything how they should. You know, some people say we should have a full-blown amnesty, and others say no, it should be limited to so many. So, yeah, you know, we agree on many of the issues, and we don't agree on all of it.
You support Russell Pierce?
I support Russell Pierce in the bill, Senate 1070.
Now, he said some of these same things. Do you support those statements by him?
What I do support is the fact that we do have a black market. You know, I was on a show where I even took Anderson 360, but I took him to drop houses. I showed him where a lot of crime was in drop houses, where they arrested 50 illegal immigrants. They beat this woman severely where she lost her baby. I have been to these places and seen them. So I can't say, you know, I do support them, because I've actually seen it. I've been to these places.
And your support for Sheriff Arpaio, which DeeDee mentioned before, is a bone of contention or a point of difference between the two groups. What do you say about that?
You know, I think And here's what the whole crazy the thing is between her group and my group, where they contradict themselves, is the fact that her, I think her attacks on Sheriff Joe is more not policy but personal. She attacks J.D. Hayworth because he takes a tough stand on illegal immigration, but her groups go out and campaigns for McCain, but he's out there making commercials like, hey, I'm going to fix the border, I'm tough on immigration, reelect me. And I say, well, where's the contradiction? You can't stand J.D. because he's anti-SB 1070, you know, he's for SB 1070, and McCain's supporting the same bill, and she doesn't come out and attack him. So,
and how do you respond to that, DeeDee? Well, because a lot of people do think that Senator McCain has gone way to the right, at least from their point of view, on the subject of immigration.
Absolutely. McCain is the experience that we need in Washington, D.C. He does not want to lose to J.D. Hayworth. He did have to move further to the right because at the time, J.D. Hayworth was 5 points inching closer to McCain.
So do you think that justifies what he has done on the subject of immigration?
Right. With regard to Jesse's concern about our hypocrisy, McCain has a history of championing Hispanic causes, like the immigration reform under Bush. That has a lot of credibility. Talk is cheap with us, and he's walked the walk. He's put his head on the chopping block for us. And I believe Hispanics voted for the wrong person. McCain is the one that put his head on the chopping block for us, not Obama. And so where's McCain's confidence level? We didn't vote for him. I did, but over 75% of Hispanics voted for Obama. So McCain's confidence went down with regard to the Hispanic people voting for him. So of course he's going to go to the right. But fact of the matter remains is that he did put his head on the chopping block for us, and talk is cheap, and his walk proves.
But does that justify him going to the right? That's the question. I mean, he was, you know, he did a bill with Senator Kennedy that was, it was pro-amnesty.
No, it was not
very
pro-amnesty.
Similar to it.
Absolutely.
And then all of a sudden
not.
He's out there tough in the talk, taking pictures by the border, doing the Clint Eastwood look, squinting in the camera, well, saying, I'm going to get the borders. Now that his points are so ahead of J.D. by 20 points, now he's talking, well, I don't know about the 14th Amendment. Well, maybe we need to look at comprehensive reform. Now he's singing a different tune because he sees he has the election in the bag. Now he's going right back, right in the center, to the middle ground. And we all know if you can't convict yourself to one side,
it's not clear that he's gone back to the center, but is that what you're anticipating, that he will?
I hope.
If he wins?
I hope that, you know, he continues to be the pioneer. I hope that he sees Hispanic growth is going to be phenomenal here in the state of Arizona. I believe he's the kind of politician that can change the Republican Party and bring it back to the party of Abe Lincoln, not Dixiecrats such as J.D. Hayworth and Russell Pierce, who I believe don't belong in our, and Schweikert, David Schweikert. Jesse Hernandez works with David Schweikert.
Thank you for clarifying
and,
that.
And I take issue with that because he was endorsed with Russell Pierce. And again, I don't see the hypocrisy with McCain because he's quoted as saying, I believe SB 1070 is the right, it is going in the right direction. He did not say he was in full support of SB 1070.
Let me do this. I'll give you a chance to respond on the Schweikert comment, but let's talk about SB 1070 because we said we would. Your group opposed it. Why?
It violates the Constitution.
The Supremacy Clause.
Correct.
Is there any role that you think is appropriate for the states to take in terms of dealing with illegal immigration?
Sure.
And what would that be?
Do what Napolitano did, put more troops at the border.
Jesse, you can make a quick comment on the Schweikert thing if you want to clarify anything, but I have the same question for you about SB 1070.
Yeah, I want to clarify that I'm an independent consultant with David Schweikert. I do not work for him. She keeps saying that. And quite frankly, it was DeeDee that introduced me to David Schweikert and pushed for me to do consulting work for him. So it's not like I do any political thing with Mr. Schweikert.
So let's talk about SB 1070. Your group supported it.
Yes.
You were very critical of Judge Bolton's decision.
Yes.
Why?
I think she did not, you know, I was in the court, as you know, we were part of the litigation. You know, we filed a brief with the Freedom Watch. And I was watching, I was in the courtroom listening to her talk and, you know, drilling the lawyers, the attorneys. I don't really think she stuck to some of the other cases that have been decided. I think she just basically, my personal opinion in our group, that she basically, she's trying to legislate from the bench.
Have you read the opinion?
I read the opinion, and I just don't, in a sense, I'm not an attorney, but from what my attorneys are telling me, that she did not go on any on previous cases. You know, they pointed out several cases that contradicts what she's talking about.
Now, most legal scholars who mm-hmm. have no particular role in mm-hmm. the litigation think that it's a very well-reasoned, thoughtful analysis of the Supremacy Clause. And they would also point out that immigration, along with bankruptcy, are the only two items in the Constitution that the Constitution talks about the need mm-hmm. for uniform national mm-hmm. policy. And therefore, they think it's a well-reasoned decision. You disagree?
I disagree because I was reading, and I wish I would have brought the notes, but when there's another constitutional scholar that just came out that she had no right ruling on the case because foreign countries involved, and when it involves a foreign country, it's out of her jurisdiction, it should go directly to the Supreme Court. And this guy was citing all this in the Constitution. So, you know, it's depending what constitutional scholar you talk to, you have difference of opinion.
Well, let me ask you this. I saw a press conference you did the day after the opinion was issued. And you suggested what many would think would be highly inappropriate conduct by a judge, that she may have been talking to President Clinton, that she may have been talking directly to President Obama, mm-hmm. that she may have been talking directly to Attorney General Holder, all things that would be completely inappropriate for any judge.
No question
about it. To have done. What basis did you have for saying that?
You know, it's just that, you know, the basis is going that the Obama administration, they tend to get involved in a lot of things. You know, some of the things, you know, I can't, of course, prove it, but, you know, they tend to get involved in a lot of things at all levels. I'm just curious to find out, and that's what I was talking about.
But why would you say that if you had no basis for that's a pretty serious charge against a judge.
That's my opinion, and that was the opinion of our attorney, and we were talking about this because the way she was talking the day before she made her judgment, it seemed like she was going to be very reasonable and go right down it. And all of a sudden, it just like she went way to the left. Now, you know, my attorney could answer that much better because, like I said, I'm not an attorney.
Now, this was several weeks ago when the decision came down. Since then, have you developed any information to support those allegations?
We have not gotten anything back. I mean, I had requested that we, you know, out of Freedom of Information Act, if we can subpoena the records, phone calls, or any type of, you know, from Bill Clinton, from Eric Holder, for anybody from the White House.
DeeDee, what do you think is going to happen? There is this tremendous divide, and there are a lot of Hispanics who think that we do need to do something about illegal immigration. They may not be as extreme as Russell Pierce or Pamela Gorman, but they do think something needs to be done, and those are the kinds of people I think Jesse's group appeals to. How do you deal with them?
I believe that we should secure our borders, but the reason why we are having this problem is because we don't have a sound immigration system. Right now, there's a bottleneck, and we need more checkpoints and create more guest worker programs so that people can be documented and come in and out of the country. Let's face it, most of the people who come here are fine with working here for a season and going back to their ranches in Mexico. Most of the undocumented, 80% of them, are ranchers, poor ranchers, and I'm a big believer in allowing a person to achieve the American dream and put food on their tables.
We've got just a little over a minute left. Let me ask you, Jesse, about another hot button issue, anchor babies. In discussions off camera with you, you indicated you might have been one, actually. You're not certain.
Yeah, not sure.
Don't we have enough controversy right now without throwing that issue into the fire?
Oh, I agree. I agree. We have a lot of controversy, especially with the Latino community, but you know, sooner or later, that's going to come down the pipeline, and you know, we have to address it one way or the other because you know, times have changed.
And we're just about out of time, so we're going to have to wrap up.
Well, you know, but I just want people to understand is that we're not anti-immigration; we're just for legal immigration. This
got
is
it.
What all was all
got
about.
It. And we've got like 5 seconds if you have anything to say. Okay.
Hi.
Well, I apologize that we ran out of time. We'll get you both back on to talk maybe after the elections. But thank you both very much.
You.
And remember, you can always go to our website, azpbs.org/horizonte, for transcripts, information on upcoming shows, and more. And that's our program for this Thursday night for all of us here at Horizonte. I'm Jose Cardenas. Have a good evening.